If the rivers and streams carry the force of life through the continent, then Missouri surely forms the heartland. For this is where our two mightiest rivers meet. The Missouri and the Mississippi, north of their joining, carry water for more than 700,000 square miles of North America. Before the building of roads and rails, these meandering waterways guided the journeys of early travelers. Native Americans were followed by trappers and traders, adventurers and explorers. They saw an exciting land, vast, rich, and untamed, one in which the land and the streams formed a fragile balance. In 1805, Meriwether Lewis described his vision of the Missouri River in a letter to his mother. "This immense river, so far as we have yet ascended, waters one of the fairest portions of the globe. Nor have we seen a country equally fertile, well-watered, and intersected by such a number of navigable streams." The rhythm of the rivers and streams set the schedules, controlled the traffic. The Missouri River itself had a swift current, shifting sandbars, and snags half hidden by turbid waters. Timbers could quickly wreck a boat, yet the boats kept coming. A steamboat owned by Captain Kinney from Boonville, Missouri, made $50,000 one year by traveling the 2,300 miles to Montana and back again. The Missouri River was, for a time, the greatest highway to the West, until the 1860s, when railroads and overland trails took over. And the land began its long, great change. Loggers, miners, farmers went up the river, up the streams, and spread across Missouri. People came, and the places changed. Pine forests of the Ozarks were cut and sent downstream to market. The land left was burned again and again by men who didn't know any better. Settlers tore into the rich prairies of bluestem and buffalo. They cleared bottomland forests to make way for new towns, new crops, new lives. And all the while, the streams and rivers kept on flowing silently by, miles and miles of waterways quietly bearing a burden that grew as the earth, burned and plowed, plowed and burned, made its way into the streams. And still today, silt and gravel continue to fill channels and pools as the waters shed what they cannot carry. Stream banks, stripped of roots, no longer hold the earth in place. Soil which once enriched the land now is washed into rivers. Artificial, straightened channels try to hold in check streams that tend to wander. The balance, it seems, has been broken. But the question is not what have we done. The question is, what will we do? And the answer lies hidden in the nature of the streams themselves. Rivers and streams are dynamic things, nearly always on the move. They're an important part of the water cycle we depend on. 3/4 of Missouri's drinking water, in fact, comes from our river systems. A stream carries life, moves life, gives life to the earth. No pipeline or concrete canal can do the same. Though we create ponds and reservoirs, we can't very well create new streams and rivers. They're uniquely of the earth, formed naturally by the lands through which they flow. A stream begins with raindrops. The raindrops glide downhill, forming rivulets, which join into draws. These flow into a growing web of channels. And finally, the land sheds its water into something big enough to be called a stream. The watershed, all this land where water has passed through on its way to the stream, gives the water its character, its purity, its life. The quality of our water, then, begins on the land. The energy of water in a stream or river comes from the force of gravity, which pulls down, always down, to the lowest point of land as the water works its way to sea level. This force makes rivers natural artists, sculptors of the landscape whose speed is slowed by bending channels. Along the banks of rivers and streams, this force, this tension, is played out constantly between the water and the land. It's why trees and other plants along the shore are so essential to hold the land in place, to maintain the fragile balance. A plant-rich river edge also filters pollutants, which inevitably head downslope into the waterways. A healthy stream is full of life. Plants and animals find all sorts of nooks and crannies to live in. Soil and gravel stay on the land. The waterways remain open and free, rather than choked by silt and gravel. Deep pools slow the rushing currents. Riffles add oxygen as the water churns across an uneven bottom. Healthy streams need to bend now and then. A straightened, channelized stream speeds the rush of water. That in turn scours the stream bed, destroying places animals and plants need to live. Channelized streams, therefore, support much less life than natural winding waterways. The streams and rivers of Missouri are a diverse lot, reflecting a great variety of landscapes. Each provides different kinds of homes. Each supports different types of plants and animals. And all rivers and streams depend on the land around them. Tumbling through rocky terrain up to a billion years old, the waters of the Ozarks rush in riffles and pause in pools. Fish like hogsuckers have adapted with flattened heads to hunker down against the swift current. Others, like darters, conquer the currents in part with oversized pectoral fins. Underground waters emerge through bubbling springs. Prairie streams work their way across gently rolling landscapes. The clay soil hangs suspended, giving the waters a more cloudy look than the clear Ozark streams. Some animals have adapted with a keen sense of touch and taste, so they're better equipped to find their food. Channel catfish whiskers rake the stream bottoms for tasty bits. Bullheads have taste organs all over their bodies to help them find food in murky water. Prairie streams teem with life. Southeastern Missouri was once covered with extensive cypress swamps. It's still a very flat land, giving rise to streams that move at a snail's pace through the sandy sediments laid down in ancient seas. In the early 1900s, much of the Boot Heel was drained for farmland, so few unaltered lowland streams remain. The greatest natural sculptors of a landscape are the big rivers. They're the water-hauling, earth-moving, catch-all carriers. They drain the 56,000 miles of streams in Missouri. They're the homes of the big fish, the paddlefish, the sturgeon, and the blue catfish. Many Missourians drink their waters. Though locks, dams, and dikes have altered the rivers, they're still home in places to lots of life. Clean, flowing water supporting all sorts of rich aquatic life. That's what Missourians once had, and now are working to win back. Some people have thrown themselves directly into the task through local conservation efforts like stream teams. They're lending a hand where they can to remove debris, monitor water, and plant stream banks. Landowners help by keeping an edge of life along the rivers, by seeing the true value in a dense corridor of trees and shrubs. But whether you own land directly at the river's edge or not, we all affect someone else downstream. So we can all help by knowing what chemicals we're using, by knowing where our trash and wastes go when they leave our homes, and by adding as little as possible to the debris on the planet. We can help by keeping a cover of grass, trees, and other plants on the earth, which hold the soil and gravel in place and out of streams and rivers. We can all help by understanding the life of a stream or river, by respecting its needs to move back and forth between stable banks, rather than in lifeless, rigid walls. For no matter how we fight them, the waters will win in the end, flowing, always flowing, down to the seas. Whether they continue to carry the force of life as well is up to us.